Good morning everyone. We will start with the next ordinals of the same chapter, the cell, the unit of life. So we'll go with the next organelle, that is the centrioles, the cilia and flagella, and the microbodies. Centrosomes, yes, the centrioles, cilia and flagella, and the microbodies. So first we will see what are centrosomes, or what do you mean by centrosomes? Especially in the animal cells, you can find these organelles only in the animal cells. In the animal cells, just above the nucleus, you will find two cylindrical structures that were very important for the formation of spindle fibers, which help in the process of cell division. Just above the nucleus, there are cylindrical structures which usually occur in pairs, which are perpendicular to each other. These are known as the centrioles, and these centrioles are present only in the animal cells. So you can find a pair of centrioles, and this pair of centrioles is known as diplosome. A pair of centrioles are known as the diplosomes. They are the cylindrical structures which are, so one is lying, the other is straight, which are at right angles to each other. This pair of centrioles is called as diplosome. And the area, this particular area, or the place where they are being located, or the area that they are being located, is called as centrosphere. The area, this particular area of the centrioles in the cytoplasm, they are suspended in the cytoplasm just above the nucleus. This area of the centrioles, a pair of centrioles, that is the diplosomes, form the centrosphere. So diplosome is a pair of the centrioles. So the centrioles and the centrosphere forms the centrosomes. So I repeat that in the animal cells, there are cylindrical structures just above the nucleus, and those cylindrical structures are called as centrioles, and this pair of centrioles are known as diplosome. The area surrounding the centrioles is called as centrosphere, and the centrioles with the centrosphere is known as the centrosomes. So let us go with the structure of the centrioles. So you will find two cylindrical structures which are at right angles to each other and are called as diplosomes. If you expand and think, each of it is made up of 9 microtubules. If you expand and see, each of it are made up of 9 microtubules. Expanded form of this or this. It is made up of 9 microtubules. Or that of a cart wheel, where there is a central wooden plank with radiating wooden bars, or we can say slabs, and the circular ring which appear to form a wheel. So here also the centrioles show cart wheel type of arrangement, where there is a central wooden circle or a central wooden part surrounded by the wooden slabs, or we can say the rods, which in turn surrounded by a circle of wooden mesh or a covering. So same way, even the centrioles have at the center, as this is the center of the wheel, even the centrioles at the center have a protein core. It is having a central protein core. This central protein core is known as hub. It is known as hub. The central protein core of the centrioles is known as the hub, and around this hub you can see 9 microtubules surrounding it. So it is surrounded by 9 microtubules. So if you go expand, or if you go in deep in the structure, each of the microtubules are made up of 3 microtubules. Again, 3 we call it as triplet microtubules. So each one of it, surrounding the hub, there are 9 microtubules. Which are named as A, B, C from the center. So it shows a cartwheel type of arrangement, where each of this tubule have 3 sub microtubules. They have 3 sub microtubules, where the microtubules are arranged with a distance of 40 degrees with each other. So it is having 3 sub microtubules, where all are named with the alphabets, or we can name them with the alphabets A, B, C, where the first microtubule is connected to the third of the next microtubule. So the first is connected to the third of the 9. So all are interconnected. This figure is not mentioned in the textbook, but for your external information, I would like to draw this figure. So the figure is being drawn. So there is a central hub with triplets microtubules. Triplets microtubules named as ABC, which are arranged at 40 degrees difference between the distance of 40 degrees centigrade and interconnect. They are interconnected, where the first microtubule is connected to the last. So it appears similar to that of a cartwheel. So if you compare with the cartwheel, the central wooden plaque, yes, is nothing, is similar to the hub. Yes, the hub, which is a central protein core of the centrioles, resemble the central rod of the wheel. So we represent the centriole as a cartwheel arrangement. So the hub is the central protein core of the centrioles, surrounded by 9 microtubules. And in turn, these 9 microtubules are made up of 3 tubules. We call them as triplet microtubules, where they are named and they are interconnected with a distance of 40 degrees angle, then where the first microtubule is connected to the last of the next alternate microtubule. So the same arrangement goes on with that. So this arrangement, we call it as 9+3 arrangement. This arrangement is usually referred to as 9+3 arrangement. So as I said, the centrioles play a very important role in the process of cell division. That is, they produce the spindle fibers, which helps in segregating the chromosomes or pulling off the chromosomes for the other process of cell division, by which we can differentiate the cell divisions as prophase, metaphase, anaphase and the telophase. So this is the structure of the centrioles. So once again, I will say that what is centrosomes? A pair of centrioles, and the area where it is present, that is centrosphere, forms the centrosomes, where at the center is a protein core, is known as the hub, surrounded by 9 microtubules. Each microtubules have 3 tubules. We call it as triplet microtubules, where it is named as A, B, C, which are differentiated at 40 degrees with each other. So it is representing 9+3 arrangement, which is similar to the cartwheel type of arrangement. Now we will go with what are the functions of these centrioles. As I said, they are present only in the animal cells. So in the animal cells, during the process of cell division, each of these microtubules will produce the spindle fibers. Just above the nucleus, they produce the spindle fibers. They segregate each other. In the next chapter, you will be studying the whole process. So, just these centrioles, when they produce the spindle fibers, they appear to be like star-like structures, small radiating thread-like structures produced by the microtubules of the centrioles are the spindle fibers. So it is helping in the formation of astes. It is involved in the formation of astes. By asters, as they appear with radiating spindle fibers or radiating structures and appear like stars, so they are involved in the formation of asters, and they help in the formation of spindle fibers. So during cell division, when the nuclear membrane dissolves, nucleolus also dissolves, the chromatin network condenses to form the chromatin. us. Hope you remember if the structure of the chromosomes. At the center of the chromosomes are the centromeres, where it is surrounded by a protein coat called as kinetic coat. So the centrioles produce the spindle fibers, get attached to the kinetic coat and help in separating the or helps in the division of the chromosomes. So these centrioles help in the formation of spindle fibers. So these spindle fibers are nothing but the thread-like structures which get attached to the kinetic core of the chromosomes. Then during the process of spermiogenesis, it is a process of formation of sperms, human sperms. So during that spermiogenesis, it helps in the formation of axial filament. During spermiogenesis, helps in the formation of axial filament. Structure of the sperm, you will be studying in the second year classes. So, spermiogenesis is the process where sperms are being synthesized or they are being produced. It's a process of formation of sperms. In this, there is a structure called as axial filament. So that axial filament is formed by the centrioles. And as I said in bacteria, while explaining the prokaryotic cells, the flagella have the bodies like the central body, the filament, and the central body and the filament. So axial filament and all. So in that, these centrioles help in the formation of the central body of the cilia and the flagella. So if you just remember the structure of a prokaryotic cell, so the bacteria have the long whip-like structure called as the filaments. So those is having a basal body, hook, and a whip-like thread-like structure called as the filament. So these are helping in the formation of. So the centrioles help in the formation of basal granules. That is nothing but the basal body of cilia and flagella. They help in the formation of the basal granules, that is the basal body of cilia and the flagella. So the centrioles help in the formation of astrocytes. They help in the formation of spindle fibers. That during spermiogenesis, they help in the formation of the axial filament of the sperm, and in the basal body, so in cilia and flagella, they are responsible for the formation of the basal granules or the basal body. So after centrioles, we will go to the next structure, that is cilia and the flagella. So in prokaryotic cells, as I said, that the bacteria, that is the cell wall, are made up of small hair like structures called as pili or fimbriae. Yes, and on one side the bacteria has having a long thread like structure, that is the flagella, which are the locomotory organs. Right, if you take the unicellular, usually these cilia and flagella are found in the protista families. For example, if you take the paramecium, This paramecium is a microscopic organelle which is also called as slipper animalcule. It is surrounded by many small hair-like structures in the paramecium with the nucleus. Small, many minute hair-like structures all over the body. They are called as the cilia. You can find in the protists and in some of the algae also. So these cilia in such organisms are not only the locomotory organs but also help in grasping the food substances. They help in locomotion and also in grasping the food substances. Why? Some of the algae like the Chlamydomonas have a long single thread-like structure called as the flagella. The Chlamydomonas, some of that wallworts, yes, they have one or two. The wallworts have two flagellas which help a colony of many cells together form the wallworts. So usually cilia are short hair-like structures while the flagella are long thread-like structures. Both are helping the process of locomotion. So if you go with this structure of the cilia and flagella, so the bacteria, if you go with the bacteria, as I said, it is having a basal body, a hook and a whip-like, filament-like structure known as the flagella. Here, in this flagella, the central body, there is a central body. That central body is called as axoneum. There is a central body, and that central body of the cilia of the flagella is known as axoneum, which in turn is made up of two circular central tubules. It is made up of two circular intertubules. The figure is in the textbook, in the NCERT textbook you can observe it. It is having two circular tubules which are known as central microtubules, which are surrounded by these central microtubules are surrounded by a sheath or a membrane known as central sheath. Yes, at the center is the central microtubules, and that is known as the central core of the cilia and flagella is known as the axoneum, where it contains central microtubules, two microtubules surrounded by a sheath called as central sheath. From this, it produces 9 radiating arms, which are called as radial spokes. The central sheath is surrounded by 9 radial spokes. This is the one radial spoke. Each of this radial spoke has 2 microtubules. Each of it is having 2 microtubules, a pair of microtubules. So you will find around the sheath there are 9 microtubules. These are interconnected with, they are interconnected to the around the central sheath. So the central sheath is surrounded by 9 radiating spokes.
Structure which helps them in the process of locomotion. Then
with the last one, we will go with the last organelle, that is the microbodies. The last organelles are the microbodies. Microbodies are usually single membrane bounded organelles which are found in both plant cells and animal cells. So these are single membrane organelles present in both plant and animal cells. Based on the functions, the microsomes, these microbodies are being classified into three types: peroxisomes, that is the peroxisomes, glyoxisomes, and melanosomes. Based on their functions in the plant cells or the animal cells, they are classified into three types. Peroxisomes. Usually, they are involved in the process of oxidation that occurs inside the cell. Already, you I think so you know about intercellular digestion. The digestion occurs within the cell where the food is being get digested or it is get oxidized. So, some of the microbodies contain the enzymes. These enzymes help in dissolving the peroxides that are being produced in our body. So those of microbodies which are involved, these are usually involved in the oxidation. They contains the enzyme called as peroxides. They contain the enzymes called as peroxides, which undergoes a process of oxidation. During oxidation process, the food is being digested within the cell. In that process, for example, what is the main function of this enzyme? If you take that, during the process of digestion, even hydrogen peroxide is being produced. So the hydrogen peroxide is harmful to the body. So this hydrogen peroxide is degraded. The hydrogen peroxide with the peroxisomes produces the peroxides, which degrades the hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen. So they undergo the process of oxidation. They contain the enzyme called as peroxides that helps in the eliminating of harmful substances in the body that have been produced during the process of digestion. Or, for example, if you take hydrogen peroxide, which can be harmful to the cell, they are being degraded by the peroxisomes into water and the oxygen. Why? Glyoxisomes, as the name indicates, glyoxisome, it is helping in converting fats. It helps to convert. It is helping to convert the fats into convert the fats into carbohydrates that usually they are found in more in number in the germinating seeds. You can find the structures of glycosomes where they are involved in converting the fats into carbohydrates, especially in the germinating seeds. Then melanosomes. These melanosomes are produced by set of cells known as melanocytes. Melanocytes which are present inside the skin, underneath of the skin. So these melanosomes, or we can say that they produce the pigment called as melanin. The melanin, which is responsible for the color of the skin. So the melanosomes are produced by a set of cells which are produced or which are present inside beneath the skin or inside the skin. Those are known as the melanocytes. So these melanosomes, the melanocytes, produces the pigment, that is the melanosomes which produces the pigment and is responsible for the color of the skin. So these are the three microbodies that are produced: peroxisomes, glyoxisomes and melanosomes. Peroxisomes contain the enzyme peroxides which help in digestion or degrading the harmful substances. For example, hydrogen peroxide is being degraded to form water and oxygen, while the glyoxisomes converts the fats into carbohydrates, especially found more in number during germinating seeds. And the melanosomes, which are produced from a group of cells which are produced beneath the cells, that is the melanocytes, which are responsible for the color of the skin. So all the organelles of the topic cell is being completed. So once again we will recollect all the topics that we have learnt. First, with the introduction of the cell, what is a cell and what are the organelles present in the cell. Then next is the cell theory. In that cell theory, we have studied the two theories proposed by the scientist, which is also called as the cell theory. Then the statement given by Rudolf Virchow, and all the organelles one by one, starting from plasma membrane. Then we have gone with the prokaryotic cells, then the eukaryotic cells. Prokaryotic cells, we have studied the structure of the bacteria based on the shapes the bacteria are being classified. Then all the organelles of the eukaryotic cells, that is, we have started with the plasma membrane, the fluid mosaic model of the plasma membrane. Then we have gone with the Golgi apparatus, mitochondria, chloroplast, endoplasmic reticulum one by one, with the nucleus, chromosomes, and this is the last section of the topic. So we have learned all the organelles of the cell. I will give you an extra information about it. You know about the structure of a prokaryotic cell and a eukaryotic. Now in a animal cell or a plant cell are said to be as eukaryotic cells. So let us find out the differences between the prokaryotic cells and the eukaryotic cells, and the difference between the plant cell and the animal cell. So in the next part, as an external information which can be gone through it. So when you compare, how do you differentiate a prokaryotic cell and a eukaryotic cell? Look to the notes. You can just go through the figure of a plant cell and an animal cell, yes, or any reference book for the prokaryotic cell. So we will start with the difference between the prokaryotic cell and the eukaryotic cell. cell. In eukaryotic cells, it includes the plants and the animal cells. So here the cell wall, prokaryotes and especially in the plant cell, the cell wall. The cell wall is made up of meiosis. So it is undergoing simple cell division, that is, it can be by mitosis, a mitosis or mitosis where eukaryotic cells go all the forms of cell division, a mitosis, mitosis and meiosis. And usually they have circular DNA. You can, as I said, that the DNA is naked, which is called as nuclei. They have a circular DNA in the cytoplasm. In the cytoplasm, while the eukaryotes have double helix DNA in the nucleus. They have double helix DNA inside the nucleus. Circular DNA, if you go with the structure of a prokaryotic cells, there is a circular DNA usually found in the cytoplasm of the prokaryotic cells. While in the eukaryotic cells, it has having a double helix DNA model, double stranded helix DNA, which is present inside the nucleus, which during the process of cell division forms the chromosomes. And they have 70s types of ribosomes. Already we have studied the ribosomes, what is S and why it is called as 70s. So usually the prokaryotes have 70s type of ribosomes, while in eukaryotes they have both. They have both 70s and 80s type of ribosomes. The prokaryotes have 70s. Already I said that S is Fredberg's unit based on sedimentation coefficient. So inside the prokaryotic cell, you will find that is 70S type of ribosomes. While in eukaryotic, you can find both 70S and 80S. Again, I said in ribosomes, there are two types, that is organelle ribosomes and cytoplasmic ribosomes. In cytoplasmic, it is usually 80S, while the organelle ribosomes like mitochondria and chloroplast have 70S ribosomes. So these are the differences between the prokaryotic cells and the eukaryotic cells that are generally classified or differentiated. It helps you to know the differences between the prokaryotic cells and the eukaryotic cells. So I just say you all, just go through the notes. Next we will see the differences between the plant cell and the animal cell. So once again we will go with here. The prokaryote, the cell wall is made up of peptidoglycan, while in eukaryotes it is made up of polysaccharides. While the cell membrane produces the inner foldings called as mesosomes, while mesosomes are absent in the eukaryotic cells. All the membrane bounded organelles like endoplasmic reticulum, Golgi complex, or the mitochondria are absent in the prokaryotes, while they are present in the eukaryotes. They have a very short cell cycle. Within 20 minutes the bacteria will divide. While they have in the human cell, if you take the eukaryotes, take the cell cycle is lengthy, which can take around 2 to 24 hours. Then it undergoes two cell divisions, can be a mitosis, commonly we call it as binary fission, or mitosis, that is equational division. While in eukaryotes it is a mitosis, mitosis and meiosis. So mitosis is equational division, meiosis is reductional division. So here they have circular DNA in the cytoplasm, while eukaryotes have double helix DNA in the nucleus. And the two forms of ribosomes, that is 70S type of ribosomes, are found in the cytoplasm of the prokaryote cells. By you can find both 70S and 80S type of ribosomes in the eukaryotic cells. Now let's make out the list of the differences. What are, how you differentiate a plant cell and an animal cell?
Centrioles
lysosomes are absent in animal cell centrioles and lysosomes between the plant cell and the animal cell. Thank you.